Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Rise of Yeast, How the Sugar Fungus Shaped Civilization, by Nicholas P. Money. Narrated by David Colacci. Wine is life. Petronius Satyricon. Yeast is life. Advertisement for Irving's Yeast Vite Tablets, 1925. 1. Introduction. Yeasty Basics. This is the story of our ancient codependence with yeast, how microbe and man have led each other through history, and how the relationship is blossoming in the 21st century. From morning toast to evening wine, yeast is mankind's daily blessing, and our communion with this little fungus is deepening year by year. It has taken us from hunting and gathering to more settled lives as farmers, provided our daily bread and fed our thirst for wine and beer. Without yeast, Earth would be an alcohol-free planet, and every loaf of bread would be unleavened. In our time, yeast has become the darling of biotechnology, generating a catalog of life-saving medicines and billions of gallons of biofuel in the quest to slow climate change. Yeast, the sugar fungus, has been civilization's invisible partner from the get-go. 10,000 years ago, our ancestors abandoned bush meat and wild fruit in favor of farming animals and cultivating grain. Leaving the forests and grasslands, our appetite for the beer and wine produced by the fungus was a major stimulus for agricultural settlement. The reason was simple. It takes a village to run a brewery or tend a vineyard. Modest consumption of alcohol by the early farmers also helped to cement social ties and foster a sense of community. And as life became more predictable within these farming communities, the technologies of brewing and baking evolved. We knew what yeast did long before we had a clue about what it was. 6,000 years ago, Sumerian brewers attributed the fermentation process to the goddess Ninkasi, and many other deities were credited with brewing alcohol in antiquity. In his famous dictionary, published in 1755, Dr. Johnson defined yeast as the foam, spume, or flower of beer in fermentation, and cross-listed with the synonym barm as yeast, the ferment put into drink to make it work. The replacement of these original religious and industrial concepts of yeast with the biological description of a microbe happened very slowly. Yeast cells were among the first microorganisms seen after the invention of the microscope in the 17th century. Anton von Leeuwenhoek examined them in drops of beer in 1680, although he did not consider that these tiny globules were alive. Chemists, including the French scientist Antoine Lavoisier, studied the fermentation process in winemaking in the next century, and investigators who saw yeast with their primitive microscopes concluded that it was produced by the fermentation process rather than vice versa. With no knowledge of germs as living entities that could carry out chemical transformations or cause disease, there was no reason to view yeast cells as anything worthy of further scrutiny. Recognition that yeast was a living thing that produced alcohol came in the 19th century. Looking at the fungus in beer, French botanist Jean-Baptiste Henri-Joseph Demazier named it Mycoderma cerevisiae. Cerevisia is Latin for beer, and called the same organism Mycoderma vini when he saw it in wine. German biologist Theodor Schwann called yeast Zuckerpilz, the sugar fungus or sugar mushroom, and his colleague Franz Mayen provided the modern Latin name in 1838, Saccharomyces cerevisiae. The combination of better microscopes and clever experiments on fermentation encouraged the conclusion that the yeast plant, as it became known, was the live agent that produced alcohol in wine and beer. Organic chemists continued to dispute these findings, choosing to believe that the objects described as cells were minerals precipitated from chemical reactions. They thought that alcohol was a product of pure chemistry rather than biochemistry. But with evidence mounting in the 1860s in favor of yeast as the catalyst, Louis Pasteur silenced most of the dissenting voices with a series of brilliant experimental demonstrations. Yeast was proven to be a living entity and recognized as a microorganism of spectacular consequence in human affairs. There is some Western bias in this assessment of yeast supremacy. Though the fungus is foundational to human civilization, our nutritional reliance on yeast is concentrated among the descendants of the Roman Empire living in Europe, North Africa, the Middle East, Australasia, and the Americas. Leavened bread has always been less important in Asian and sub-Saharan African cultures. Alcohol consumption follows a more complex demography. Practitioners of Islam, Mormonism, and many other Christian denominations are teetotal, but at least 2 billion humans enjoy brewed and distilled beverages today. According to Pliny, unleavened bread was replaced by loaves raised with yeast after the Third Macedonian War, 171 through 168 BC. Wine production peaked in the Roman Republic at around the same time, and vineyards spread across the conquered territory of Europe to meet the demands of a rapidly growing population. Leavened bread has held its own in the Western diet over the 2,000 years since Pliny's departure, and our love of wine and beer is undiminished. The allure of alcohol is undeniable. If yeast had never evolved, we would have been forced to invent it. Wine and beer change our perception of the moment, can make us glory in life, and be our downfall when absorbed too freely. Alcohol can help us slide from heaven to hell and vice versa. It bathes the central nervous system, acting both as a powerful stimulant and depressant, which explains the effects of different doses ranging from mild euphoria to death. Its legality allows us to overlook the true nature of this yeast product as a potent psychoactive drug. Supernatural mediation in the experience of inebriation was imagined throughout the ancient world, and alcoholic gods and goddesses flourished, including Dionysus and his Roman manifestation Bacchus, the Aztec god Tezcatlipoca, and the Sumerian goddess Ninkasi mentioned earlier. Wine is the essential beverage of the Bible, of course. Benjamin Franklin wrote, "Behold the rain which descends from heaven upon our vineyards. There it enters the roots of the vines to be changed into wine, a constant proof that God loves us and loves to see us happy." For those of agnostic persuasion, we may toast the evolutionary roots of our little fungus. To appreciate the power of yeast, we must define what it produces. Alcohol is one thing and many things. It refers to ethyl alcohol, or ethanol, and to members of the class of chemicals with a similar structure. Other alcohols include methanol, wood alcohol, sorbitol, a common sugar substitute, and menthol, from mint. Chemicals ending in -ol, which signifies the presence of a hydroxyl group, OH, are alcohols. Here, however, alcohol will be used in the colloquial sense to refer to ethanol. This small molecule comprises a pair of carbon atoms bonded to hydrogen atoms and to a single hydroxyl group, CH3CH2OH. Alcohol is a rare molecule in nature. Besides its formation by yeast, alcohol synthesis is limited to germinating seeds and a few kinds of bacteria. The bacteria tend to generate unpleasant flavors that can spoil beer and cider, so they offer little competition with yeast for the affections of brewers. Alcohol is also forged in the absence of biology in interstellar clouds. The largest molecular cloud close to the center of the Milky Way, called Sagittarius B2, contains enough alcohol for 10 to the 28th power bottles of vodka, which incidentally would weigh 5 times as much as all of the planets in the solar system. Yeast uses glucose and other sugars to fuel the dynamism of its cells. Energy is harvested from these molecules by splitting them into smaller parts and stripping energized electrons from their component atoms. Stripping electrons is called oxidation. When there is enough oxygen around, yeast has the option of breaking down glucose through two sets of reactions, capturing energy along the way, and leaving nothing in its wake but water and carbon dioxide, CO2. Stage 1 is called glycolysis, and stage 2, the citric acid cycle. This process of aerobic respiration is like a controlled burn that wrings the maximum amount of energy from the available fuel. Oxygen puts yeast into overdrive, and the fungus roars along like a Ferrari. But yeast cells in beer, wort, and grape juice soon deplete the oxygen because the dissolved gas diffuses slowly through these sugary fluids. This blocks the more lucrative reactions of the citric acid cycle. Oxygen starvation can also limit the performance of a sports car, and this is fixed with turbochargers that force more air into the fuel mixture. In similar fashion, brewers aerate their beer wort to optimize growth of the yeast, especially at the beginning of the fermentation process. This support is helpful in brewing, but the fungus is proficient at adjusting to the loss of oxygen and can keep running in a different fashion. It does so by adopting an anaerobic burn or fermentation. This does not get as much energy out of the sugar molecules as aerobic respiration, but succeeds in meeting the immediate needs of a growing population of yeast cells. The residual energy is exhausted by the cell in the form of alcohol. The compromise involved in leaving all those calories behind in the alcohol is well worth it because the chemical exhaust poisons every other fungus and bacterium that would like to compete for the sugars that allow yeast to thrive. This is so effective that yeast doubles down on its metabolic wager by choosing to produce alcohol even when there is plenty of oxygen around. Making do with this leaner diet is worth it if it keeps hordes of hungry microbes at bay. This strategy, called the Crabtree effect, is a critical part of the natural behavior of yeast. It works because yeast has evolved an extraordinary tolerance to ethanol and explains how the sugar fungus enjoys almost free rein to bubble away in rotting fruit and sweet plant sap. In brewing, the Crabtree effect allows yeast to make alcohol before and after oxygen levels fall. Yeast produces alcohol until the level rises to between 10% and 15%, which kills the fungus. This process limits the alcohol content of beer and wine. Things work a little differently in nature, where yeast has the potential to keep growing after a period of fermentation by devouring its own alcohol. This metabolic dexterity allows the fungus to create, concentrate, and consume alcohol. Yeast fell into its intimate relationship with alcohol after an abnormal act of copulation. Around 100 million years ago, when pterosaurs wheeled in the skies, a couple of yeast cells that had been building in tree sap nudged against each other and mated. This liaison caused a genetic eruption called whole genome duplication. Offspring produced from the normal mating reactions have the same number of genes as either of their parents. In this instance, infant sugar fungi were born with double the number of genes. 10,000 instructions coded in the DNA of each cell rather than the usual 5,000 gene recipe for making yeast. As time passed, most of the new copies of genes were removed from the genome and only 10% or so of the proteins made by today's yeast are encoded in genes derived from the genome duplication event. But the consequences of this genetic eruption were momentous for us, because yeast acquired the ability to process lots of glucose and make lots of alcohol. This prepped the fungus to become our companion in brewing. The timing of the genome duplication is critical to the story of yeast, because the same doubling of information content happened to the Cretaceous ancestors of the flowering plants that went on to produce fleshy fruits. The intersection of these events was crucial, because fleshy fruits are the natural source of the sugars that yeast uses to make alcohol. Yeast and the plants that manufacture its sweet food emerged from these ancient genetic explosions at around the same time. Copying of individual genes is a major player in evolution because it provides opportunities for the replicas of genes to assume novel functions. Wholesale changes in the number of genes in an organism are more likely to be catastrophic unless the expression of all of these new instructions can be tightly regulated. Genome duplications may happen quite often on a timescale of tens of millions of years, but go unnoticed because most of the offspring delivered with more than the usual amount of DNA wither at birth. The profitable duplications of the genomes of yeast and flowering plants were extraordinary events in evolutionary history. The discovery of yeast's effectiveness in raising bread dough was more serendipitous than its adoption for brewing, and would have escaped our attention if we had not made beer and wine first. Bread will never rise without a big shot of fresh yeast, and the most likely source was an accidental splash of aromatic froth from the top of a beer vat. Finding itself in moistened cereal flour, the yeast began with a two-stage process of aerobic respiration, digesting sugars in the dough as it was needed, releasing water and CO2. Alcoholic fermentation would have kicked in too, as oxygen levels dropped, releasing alcohol and more bubbles of CO2 into the dough. The sight of the rising dough must have seemed magical to the early bakers. It remains so today. Bakers faithful to unleavened bread must have discarded these deformities until someone with a sense of adventure decided to put them in an oven. This was nothing less than an act of culinary heroism, on par with the invention of ice cream. The popularity of leavened bread across the centuries suggests that one of these pioneers escaped death by stoning and became a celebrity chef. The fungal catalyst for brewing and baking is a marvelous micro-machine crammed with 50 million proteins and other biomolecules. It has a diameter of 0.004 millimeters, 4 microns, which is 4 times wider than a bacterium and half the diameter of a red blood cell. When food is abundant, the ellipsoidal yeast cell swells for an hour or two, then squeezes a bud from its surface. Effectively, it gives birth. This yeast birth culminates with the formation of a partition between mother and infant. Each bud bears a birth scar on the baby's surface, a solitary umbilicus, and leaves a matching pockmark or birth scar on the mother, who immediately begins to make a new bud at the opposite end of the cell. The mother keeps budding, switching from one pole to the other. At times when separation is delayed, mothers carry the next generation around on their surface. Granddaughters may cling to daughters, too, so that a multi-generational colony shaped like a ginger root casts itself in the bread dough or jiggles in beer froth. After a few days, both ends of the mother cell are embellished with necklaces of birth scars, emblems of her productive life. Death comes for the yeast after a brief post-reproductive retirement. Meanwhile, her offspring keep growing and budding. The beer bubbles rise, and so too does the dough. We use feminine nouns to describe budding yeast. She, the mother, always gives birth to daughter cells. This sounds right. The father produces multiple daughter cells or sons on his surface does not. After all, mothers give birth. This does not mean that yeast cells belong to a single gender, however, because the cells come in two versions, or mating types, designated A and alpha. These look the same, and both types form buds. Their difference lies in their fragrance. The two mating types release distinctive kinds of chemical attractant when mating occurs. There is no obvious male yeast, just two kinds of parent in these sexual mergers. When yeasts detect the perfume of the opposite mating type, their surfaces bulge so that both cells resemble gourds. The bulges are called schmooze, in continuing deference to a rare display of professional merriment by geneticists who related them to the promiscuous cartoon creatures introduced by the American artist Al Capp, who gave Americans the comic strip Little Abner in 1948. Schmoo-to-schmoo kissing creates fusion, like the fertilization of an animal egg by a sperm. The big cells created by fusion can keep growing, but when the supplies of sugars dwindles, they construct survival capsules called ascospores. Later, when more food becomes available, the spores germinate to release the next generation of yeast cells. This cycle of life has kept yeast going in something very close to its present form for the last 5 to 10 million years. Besides its efforts in making wine, beer, and bread, yeast has become indispensable in the modern science of molecular genetics and as the workhorse of the biofuel industry. Yeast is an archetypal model system for research, chosen for its potential to uncover the ground rules of biology. The gut bacterium Escherichia coli was the first model microbe chosen by scientists who wanted to disentangle the molecular basis of heredity. Yeast is more complicated than this bacterium, but it has the advantage of telling us a lot more about human biology because it is much closer to us in its way of life. Bacterial genes are encoded in a single chromosome that is organized as a ring of DNA that is immersed in the fluid interior of the cell. Like our cells, yeast has multiple chromosomes housed within a separate cell compartment called the nucleus. Cells without a nucleus are called prokaryotic, and cells with them are eukaryotic. Bacteria are prokaryotes. Yeasts are eukaryotes, and so are humans. This means that what we learn about the way that yeast cells manage their lives may tell us a lot about how we get by. Yeast has several attractions as an experimental organism besides its eukaryotic architecture. The fungus goes about its daily business with a single set of 16 chromosomes. Cells like this, which contain a single set of chromosomes, are described as haploid. Animal and plant cells with two sets of chromosomes are diploid. Being diploid means that the effects of one version of a gene, called an allele, can be masked by another version of the same gene on the matching chromosome. This allows us, like Gregor Mendel's pea plants, to pass mutated versions of genes to our offspring without displaying their effects ourselves. An imbalance in fat metabolism, for example, can be passed to a child from both parents that carry a defective gene, yet enjoy healthy levels of fat storage themselves. The errant version of the gene carried by both parents hides behind the uncorrupted gene on their second version of the same chromosome. But without a second copy of each chromosome in yeast, the effects of every bad gene are made immediately apparent. Mutation of a single gene affecting lipid management, for example, causes all the yeast cells to fill with globules of fat. This vulnerability makes yeast a useful model for research on obesity and other diseases with a genetic basis. Breakthroughs in the study of yeast genetics have driven the industrial uses of the fungus way beyond its innate talents as a brewer and baker. Genetically modified, GM, yeast strains are used to produce a range of drugs, including human insulin, vaccines, and an injectable medicine to treat eye degeneration. It is easy to take the improvements in healthcare made possible by genetic engineering for granted, and tempting, given their astonishing profits, to malign the companies that make our medicines. This criticism, which can be justifiable, should be balanced with the reflection that insulin produced by yeast and bacteria allows millions of people with diabetes to control their blood sugar levels and circumvent limb amputation, blindness, and heart attacks. Life without this remarkable medicine used to be nasty, brutish, and shortened. The vaccine against human papillomavirus, HPV, which is the dominant cause of cervical cancer, is another yeast product whose power should disgrace a faith healer and stupefy a shaman. Interesting yeast strains isolated from nature have also proven very useful without any genetic modification in the lab and are making biofuels from slurries of sugars extracted from corn and sugarcane. The United States specializes in corn or maize ethanol, and Brazil is the leader in biofuel production using sugarcane. Corn kernels are packed with starch that has to be converted into sugars before yeast can make any ethanol. This chemical transformation is achieved by cooking a mash of kernels with powerful enzymes that come from other fungi and from bacteria. Sugarcane is a superior crop plant for bioethanol because juice squeezed from its fibrous stems are already rich in sugars that yeast will convert into ethanol. Ethanol from corn and sugarcane are examples of first-generation biofuels. Second-generation biofuels come from fibrous agricultural waste, often called biomass. This represents a massive source of untapped energy. Most of the substance of crop residues, like wheat straw, is made from sugars that could be converted into ethanol, but they are locked inside larger molecules called polysaccharides that resist digestion by yeast. If we could create a single yeast strain, or a community of yeasts, which could release the sugars from this biomass, we could solve our energy needs long into the future and abandon fossil fuels for good. The holy grail for biotechnology is a single yeast strain genetically modified to make ethanol in this fashion. But we are a long way from transforming the sugar fungus into a microbe that can thrive on fiber. As the planet warms, the quest for this ultimate biofuel factory may become recognized as the most important mission in the history of science. The story of yeast is more than a biography of a single species. Yeast is so many different things. The name yeast refers to the yeast, Saccharomyces cerevisiae, the vaginal yeast Candida albicans, and many other species of single-celled fungi. Whether or not they ferment sugars and release ethanol, yeasts live on a diet of simple foods. In nature, they contribute to the decomposition part of the carbon cycle by digesting substances produced by plants and animals, or dissolving the post-mortem remains of their tissues. All of these inconspicuous fungi share an affinity for growth in fluid habitats, and many of them are able to cope with diminishing levels of oxygen that asphyxiate other forms of life. The fifth edition of the Yeastologist's Bible, The Yeasts, a Taxonomic Study, describes nearly 1,500 species. The majority of them, including Saccharomyces and Candida, are ascomycete fungi, members of the phylum Ascomycota. Yeasts are the least comely members of this brand of organisms, whose larger representatives include brightly colored rock lichens, woodland cups decorated with eyelashes, and fragrant morels that plead for cream sauce. Harvard mycologist Roland Thaxter was so captivated by the anatomy of the ornamented flasks of minuscule species of ascomycete that grow on insect cuticles that he spent 30 years illustrating their charms. Saccharomyces has never had an artistic champion of Thaxter's talents. If one were inspired, he or she would be classed as a minimalist. The significance of Saccharomyces in human affairs, and as a model for cell biology and genetic research, tends to overshadow the value of other yeasts. But one particular important species has played a huge role in scientific progress. Sir Paul Nurse, Sir Timothy Hunt, and the unknighted American scientist Leland Hartwell were awarded the 2001 Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine for their work on the mechanisms that govern the division of cells. The model for the experiments by Paul Nurse was the fission yeast, Schizosaccharomyces pombei, rather than the sugar fungus. When we consider the lifestyles of other yeasts, the picture of mankind's helpmate becomes more convoluted with the realization that our bodies provide many of these microscopic fungi with their living. Our skin surface, ears, noses, mouths, vaginas, and digestive systems teem with a variety of yeasts. The activities of many of these species are unclear, and the only reason we know about them at all is that their genes show up on cotton swabs and in fecal samples. The gut yeasts probably work alongside the more numerous bacteria in the digestion of our food. Yeasts on our skin also interact with bacteria and are considered part of the healthy microbiome, the galaxy of microorganisms that we carry on and inside our bodies. Dandruff is related to the growth of a yeast called Malassezia globosa in skin flakes, and it is controlled by antifungal agents incorporated into medicated shampoos. Malassezia consumes fatty sebum secreted into hair follicles and competes for food with resident Demodex mites. Swarming with yeast and mites, we are walking ecosystems. Candida albicans is a more important yeast from a clinical perspective. It is a natural component of the microbiome that becomes a problem when the healthy populations of microorganisms in the vagina are disrupted by antibiotic treatment. Candida can also be very dangerous when it invades the tissues of patients with damaged immune systems. Other yeasts can also cause these illnesses, called opportunistic infections, including black yeasts with heavily pigmented cell walls. The phenomenon of the opportunistic infection confuses the ostensible distinction between a fungus that promotes our well-being and a fungus that makes us ill. Even the sugar fungus can turn nasty if it is implanted in someone during surgery. Putting aside a handful of case histories in the medical literature describing human infections involving the sugar fungus, the blessings of our favorite yeast are everywhere when you look for them. Nicholson's Pub in Cincinnati has served as a sanctuary for me for many years. The fruits of our association with yeast are manifest in this saloon, with beers on draft, bottles of malt whiskey glinting on glass shelves backed by mirrors, and hot rolls in breadbaskets on tables. Leaving the pub after a recent visit, merging with the stream of people on the sidewalk, I noticed that more than half of the pedestrians were marked with a gray cross on their forehead. It was Ash Wednesday. Cincinnati Catholics, decorated by the priests at Holy Communion, had also received the blessings of bread and wine, the body and blood of Christ. The sacramental wafers were unleavened, but every sip of the wine was fermented by the fungus. And the cars and trucks streaming through the city streets that afternoon were running on fuel blended with bioethanol made by Saccharomyces. Civilization runs on a deep symbiosis with the sugar fungus. 2. Yeast of Eden. Drink. At night, in the rainforests of Malaysia, drops of nectar collected within the huge flower stalks of the Bertam palm are fermented by a community of yeasts. The resulting plume of alcohol that wafts through the woods makes pen-tailed tree shrews twitch their nostrils in anticipation. Climbing the palms after nightfall, these little mammals with feathery tails guzzle enough of the sweet liquor to match the alcohol consumption of a human who enjoys a strong cocktail, followed by an entire bottle of wine. Chemical analysis of hair samples from the tree shrews shows that they are chronic drinkers, though videos of them recorded with night vision cameras reveal no signs of drunken or disorderly behavior. They move around the trees with the steadiness of tightrope walkers, sidestepping the fearsome spines that ornament the leaves and flowers. Their evident sobriety is remarkable. Few of us would fare well if we tried to negotiate a fence of razor wire after a bottle of claret. There is no entertainment value in alcohol for a tree shrew. Inebriation would be a death sentence for an animal navigating a forest of spiny plants and sharp-toothed predators. Alcohol is merely a signal for the tree shrew that sugary nectar is nearby, the reward for its unconscious transfer of pollen from tree to tree. Researchers speculate that the mammal bypasses any side effects by burning off the ethanol very quickly, detoxifying the nectar and enjoying this valuable source of natural sweetness. Yeasts grow wherever they find sugars, and the tropical palms offer an attractive nursery for billions of budding cells. Bertam palms produce nectar for several weeks, exuding syrup between the petals of their woody flowers. Fermentation takes place in special brewing chambers where the fluid is trapped between the tightly packed flower buds and becomes so feverish that the nectar froths with bubbles of CO2. Because alcohol evaporates, the strength of the brew drops quite quickly, but the continuous production of the sugary liquor by the palm keeps the yeasts fed and the alcohol flowing, maintaining the bait for pollinators from the surrounding forest. This intentional explanation of the rainforest brewery, intentional meaning adaptive on the part of the palm, links the anatomy of the flower chambers to the fermentation of nectar and the role of alcohol as an advertisement to pollinators. The pen-tailed tree shrew is not the only visitor. The Sunda slow loris is another nocturnal drinker, and rats and squirrels explore the aromatic flowers day and night. We do not know how often brewing takes place in flowers of other plant species as a pollination aid. It seems logical that plants which produce their own scents and use colorful petals to attract insects would have little need for yeast and its alcohol. Nevertheless, a variety of yeasts are found in the flowers of many plant species, and a number of these fungi are capable of fermenting sugars and producing a plethora of odors. The evolution of an unusual plant called Solomon's lily, which grows in Israel, provides one line of evidence that yeasts may be more important for attracting pollinators than botanists have recognized. Close relatives of this flower attract beetles and other insect pollinators by smelling of dung and urine. Solomon's lily takes a different tack entirely, releasing a bouquet that resembles a fruity wine. It performs this trick on its own, without secreting nectar and cultivating any yeasts. Fruit flies, attracted by the odor of yeasts in rotting fruit, are fooled into carrying pollen without enjoying any nectar for their service.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.